first you fall, then you fly, and you believe that you belong up in the sky. Flap your arms as you run. Charted hemispheres, wake up with the stars.
I see myself primarily as a solo artist. Every now and then I hire a band or a player, and that's always a bit of a challenge for me. I enjoy the time on stage with them a whole lot more than I enjoy the time in the car with them. I really like traveling alone. I enjoy the freedom of making decisions based on what I want when I want it. I like going to places on a whim. I veer off the highway and into God knows what, God knows where. So the freedom of traveling alone is a great joy for me. I do experience a lot of joy on stage with players. I just wish we could live in a Star Trek world where I could dematerialize them after the show and rematerialize them on stage in the next town. That said, no, it's not hard to play these songs solo. I do feel like they have a sort of a troubadour ring to them, and they're so personal. It's almost better to play from my heart to your heart. They're naked songs in a way. They are about the process of grieving a tremendous loss and coming to peace and to terms with that. And hopefully at the end of the song cycle, being made better for it. There's a deepening that happens when we lose someone. We either get better or we get bitter. And you're not looking at a bitter woman. I think I got better. But that's not easy. The opening of the heart hurts. It's a stretching of the muscle that aches, and I tried to capture that in these songs. It's not pop music. My name like she did before. It's always therapeutic to write songs for me. I'm not trying to write for radio or for anyone other than God herself. So what I try to do is take chaos and confusion and turn it into something that makes sense. And in that sense, it's very therapeutic. Is that what we go to therapy for, to take our chaos and turn it into a story that we can then understand and then take some kind of control and responsibility for? So is it therapy? No. I am in therapy and probably will be for the foreseeable future, and have been for a long time. So I need therapy and songwriting and other things. I mean, there's a whole lot of things that have to go right for me to be in one piece on a daily basis. And it's not a solo thing like playing these songs, believe me. But yes, it's therapeutic to write the songs. It sure is. Makes sense out of nonsense. That helps. I got me an apartment on the east side, 1411 13th Street. I walk on the tracks by the Cumberland River, over the bridge, past Lover's Leap. I'm moving on through the pain, through the pain. I can see my breath disappear in the cold winter night. Bums are gathering driftwood down by the river. Whistle blows a lonesome cry. Another train, there'll be another train. there's something that happens when we hear the truth, and the truth is a sacred thing, and the paradox of art is that oftentimes art is a lie that points to the truth. And so I'm working in a medium where sometimes I have to lie to get you to believe the truth behind what I'm saying, or see it, feel it. But you know it when you feel it. There's a physical reaction to it. And there's no going back from that. You've experienced something that you know is true. I think that the best way to address songs that make change in the world is not in a macro way. You know, I've always felt as though the best way to talk about the war is to tell a soldier's story. You can't talk about the war. Our mind doesn't comprehend it. You know, the best way to talk about the hobo lifestyle is to tell you the story of one hobo, Steam Train Maury. You know, I wrote a song called Goddamn HIV. It's one of my early songs, and thousands of people have come up to me after hearing that song and have told me, my goodness, I understand that virus could have been contracted by one of my children. It opened the heart. Songs open the heart, and it helps us to understand each other better. I think that's a really good use of songs and songwriting, is to bring people together. And when hearts are opened, the world changes. It sure does. Steam Train Maury died last night. His wife Wanda was by his side. He caught the westbound out of here, hopped the high irons to the by and by. They say he jumped 10,000 trains, rode a million miles for free, helped out at VA hospitals and penitentiaries. Dandy day. Sweet Lady Sugar Cane, Deadeye Kate and the Baloney Kid raise their cups tonight in Steam Train's name. Senators and congressmen, puppets on a string, among windswept vagabonds, Steam Train was the king. He was the last. The last of The stories he bought from them helped him to write The Grapes of Wrath. But boxcars have been sealed for years, and trespassers do time. Railroad yards are razor wired, and now hoboing's a crime. So here's to you, steam train Maury. Hold that westbound tight as you ride off into history. The last hobo, the last ride, the last of the hobo kings. He was the last. Myself as a writer, fundamentally and primarily, I'm a writer. My voice is limited, and I have got very, very small range, and that used to freak me out, and it made me feel somehow not worthy of singing. But then I realized, geez, my heroes have limited range, and they're fundamentally writers, and everybody's cut them a break. So the audience that is drawn to writing will come to a writer's show. The audience that's drawn to singers will go to a singer's show, and there's enough people in the world for both of us to have careers if the singing's good enough and if the writing is good enough. I think of myself as a writer, but I do also think that my voice is adequate, and sometimes even more than adequate, for the type of songs I write. I think I can deliver them in a way that is true and real. And I think that's what great singing is. I think great singing has a lot to do with emotional impact. Do you feel it when I sing it? That's what I think it's about, is taking what's in my heart and somehow transmitting it through the vibrations of my voice to your heart. And if that happens, then it was a success. And so in that sense, I'm a singer. But I would never call myself one first. I'm a writer first. All I want to do is write songs and play them. And I want to write a whole lot more songs with the soldiers. That was incredible for me, sitting with those soldiers and getting their stories and using my gift in a way that felt like such a good use and right use of my gift, to turn those stories into something. Talk about chaos. War is chaos. And taking that and turning it into a song that then the other soldiers were all embracing. The reason it works is because there's 15 soldiers, and they're talking to each other, really. And we're just voyeurs and scribes. We're asking them questions, but they're talking to each other. There is a resistance at first, because they are not supposed to talk, especially about what really happened. Getting them to do so requires getting their trust. And so what we do and what we will do is, first of all, they get a co-write on the song. It means they own half of it. It's ownership. These will be owned by me and the soldiers. And the second thing is every single line they approve. If it doesn't feel right to them, I go rewrite it until they go, that's it. That's how it went. So that they're not ever going to be misquoted or taken out of context. I won't say anything that they don't check off and say, yes, that's how it was. And when I create a fiction to get to their truth, I'll explain why I did it that way, and they'll go, that's good. Then saying it exactly the way it happened isn't the best, that it might be good to go around it and get to it, because the emotional truth is what we're aiming for. And so in that, those two things, they feel safe, that they get veto power and that they have ownership, literally copyright. And I think that's only fair. It is their story. And I really am amazed at the process of taking people who've been traumatized, getting them to talk in a group, turning it into songs, playing the songs for the group, and watching how the trauma can be lifted. It dissipates. It's like taking weight off of a human being's heart. You can see them lighten up. A lot of them come in under ball caps and kind of like this. And by the end, they're like that. They're looking up. They got their arms around each other. They can't wait for the next round. They're better in a lot of ways. I mean, they're not fixed, but it helps. It helps. It's a powerful thing. I think trauma is something that happens to separate you from the group, and it's an instant. It's like a giant razor blade. It's like, whoosh, it comes and separates you out, and then you can't get back into the group. And that separateness hurts so much. And I think that's part of why we see so much suicide among vets coming back, because they can't come home. They can't get through that wall of glass that separates them from the home that they once knew. It's the trauma. There's 15 combat vets that have my heart. Every single one of them has a piece of my heart. You know, the love I feel for those soldiers and the service that they gave and the duty that they rose to and the selflessness that they exhibited was beyond anything that I've ever experienced in my life. You know, I hang around musicians. Our idea of being unselfish is not grimacing if we're on stage with someone swapping songs and we don't like the person's song. You know, we don't live in a world of self-sacrifice. And listening to what these soldiers did and how they literally would die for one another, it transformed me. It gave me an insight into what human beings could do for each other and have done for each other in scenarios I can't imagine. That said, I still want to write the song that ends war. But these people are incredibly courageous, and they wince if you call them heroes. It's an insult. They don't want to be called heroes. To them, a hero is the soldier who gave their life, and it's not comfortable for any of them to be singled out for heroism. They function as a group, and they don't want to be singled out. This next song is called Iraq. And I co-wrote it with a female veteran. I had the wonderful opportunity to do songwriting with soldiers a few weeks back. And there were 4 songwriters and 15 soldiers. And our job was to get a song for every one of them. And we had a day and a half. And we managed to write 15 songs in a day and a half. And each vet got their song. This is one of the ones I wrote 4 of the 15, co-wrote with the soldiers and other writers. And this is a story about a woman who was in the Army, and she was a mechanic. And there were only 2 female mechanics, and they worked on small engines. And in the Army, small engines are 15 tons and below. So this is her story. Was an Army mechanic. I worked with the men. I worked on my back. I tried to fit in. Torque wrenches and ratchets, multimeters and scales. Grease on my face, grease on my hands, grease under my nails. And it was so hard to see until it attacked. But my enemy wasn't Iraq. Soldiers bartered and traded. That's the way our world worked. Trading favors for favors, and the sand and the dirt. That I wrote it with is named Brandy. She's an African-American woman, long, beautiful dreads, a very feminine woman. She wore blue, flowing, beautiful colored skirts, fingernails manicured with the beautiful polish. She was very well put together, very attractive, and president of her high school class. She was an achiever, joined the National Guard because she wanted to go to college, which was most of their stories. They joined the Guard to go to college, and they ended up in the desert. It's just bad timing on their part. So she ended up in the Army Reserve, and then they brought her to Iraq. She was sexually harassed from the minute she got there. They cut off her nails, they cut off her hair, they took away the feminine things that were unique to her, but still a feminine woman moves like a feminine woman. She was still incredibly attractive. And you got to remember, she was 19 years old. She was a baby. And so she started telling me her story, and she went from class president to this woman who doesn't know what to do with her life. She doesn't know where to go. She's not sure who she is. She's lost. And she started talking about all of the injustices. And what I finally came up with her was the question, I hear you naming a lot of enemies, a lot of problems, but I don't hear any of them being listed as Iraqis. She goes, oh, my enemy wasn't Iraq. Boom. So there's the song. Once I got the title on the top of the page, I just told her, look, give me an hour. I'm going to go in the room and try to put what you told me together into a story. And we went back and forth. And in fact, we 2 weeks ago, we did one more back and forth on an email just to make sure I had it the way that she was comfortable with me saying it. But she's just one of millions. First you fall, then you fly, and you believe that you belong up in the sky. Flap your arms as you run. Charted hemispheres, wake up with the stars falling down around your ears. When they hit the ground, they're nothing but stones. That's how you learn to live alone. Yourself in pieces in the things that you don't say. You're not here, but you're still there. The sun goes up, the sun goes down, and you're not sure you care. You live inside the falls till you don't recognize the truth. Send you pictures, and you can't believe it's you. It's been years since your house has felt like home. That's how you learn to live alone. That's how you learn to live. It's not wrong, it's just hard to start again this far along. Brick by brick, the letting go. Resistance, lean into the wind. The roof begins to crumble, and the rain comes pouring in. And you sit there in that rubble till the rubble feels like home. That's how you learn to live alone. Thank you.
live alone.
I love what you've done to this room. I think the cafe is beautiful and comfortable. You created a great vibe. You turned it into a small theater. This could be Germany. You know, I've played cafes like this in Germany, a lot of them. It's got a very artist-friendly feeling to it. And I think you'll get the best performances out of artists with this this setup. I think it is very comfortable, and congratulations to you for creating a very comfortable place for the audience and the artists.
Get down on my knees.
down on my knees. By Robert Johnson's grave, pray my soul back to me. Oh, so I have sold you away. Oh, my soul, I sold you away. Oh, my soul, I sold you away. Oh, my soul, I sold you away. Oh, soul, I sold you away. Oh, my soul, I sold you away. Somebody early on, I can't remember if it was a producer or one of my artist friends, said, you've written your blood on the tracks. You know, that was, Bob wrote that at the height of his powers when his marriage was coming undone. And I would say I'm probably at the height of my powers right now. I'm aware of that. I've worked very, very hard to get there. I don't know how long this will last. I feel very productive. I feel songs are pouring out of me. Consequently, I think this probably is the best record I've made thus far. An artist can't know what's next. You know, there'll be a career arch for sure. You'll peak and there'll be that arc. I could get better. I don't know. I know I want to. All I want to do is be the best writer that I have the capacity to be. And it means listening harder, really. Listening more. Listening. Really listening. Great work comes from great listening. And I'm working on a memoir that I'm trying to put together as a series of short stories, so like a slideshow of scenes, outstanding scenes, and trying to tell it in short story form, which is utterly challenging. Songwriters hear things in a very dense way. Like we got to get into one line what it would take a chapter sometimes for a book. We got to just compress it in because we got 4 minutes to get our point across. So the long form is different for me, and it's very challenging. But when I'm not on the road and going from town to town and I have time off that's unstructured, I go right back to working on that. And I enjoy it, although it's torturous. It's like going to the gym. I enjoy it in the sense that when it's over, I go, that was great. And I think I'm going to enjoy having the last word with a lot of these people that mess with me in my life. Writers get the last word, right? You know, it's like, okay, this is the day we tell this story.
Mr. Turner.